Earhart. Lana Torizi. Earhart. Elena Torizi. Chapter 1. Veronica's hand flew to her chest, her fingers trembling, as an invisible weight pressed down against her. The classroom, once buzzing with energy, spun into a dizzying blur. She could hear the echo of a student's question, the words stretched and gargled, as if underwater. As the darkness clawed in, a familiar voice whispered through the chaos, a voice that belonged to a world beyond. It was her father who had left years ago. Each blackout had brought his words closer, a message shrouded in the mystery of the afterlife. Consciousness returned as a jolt, the sterile lights of a hospital corridor piercing Veronica's eyes. The rhythmic clicking of the gurney's wheels on the linoleum floor anchored her back to reality. But the reality was that these were no ordinary migraines. They were a bridge to something beyond, something both terrifying and alluring. Her father's messages were becoming clearer and more urgent. Lying there, the murmurs of nurses and the beep of machines fading into a distant symphony, Veronica knew a decision loomed over her. She could no longer shield her students, nor herself, from the unknown dangers of these episodes. The resignation was inevitable, but it was no longer about the job she was leaving behind, but rather about the gateway to uncovering a truth beyond the shadowy corners of her mind about her father that summoned from the supernatural. When her sons arrived at the hospital to persuade her to step down, she needed little convincing. However, without her income, paying the monthly mortgage would be impossible. She would have to sell the house. And since none of her sons offered to take her in, she faced some difficult choices, a low-budget trailer home or a chintzy apartment. Was she really this desperate? She yearned for something better. A nostalgic image of her childhood home, a beautiful Spanish white stucco hacienda with a red tile roof, beamed ceilings, and a room featuring a balcony, flashed before her eyes. Anger and resentment welled up within her as she remembered how her sister Karina had sold their childhood home to pay off her gambling debts. How could she have let it go for such a paltry sum? The house was now worth double. Could she settle for a trailer home in her retirement, her so-called golden years? But then, inspiration struck. Veronica was her father's daughter, after all. She recalled that he had left her a beach house in Mexico, which her sister had been maintaining, because Veronica couldn't afford the upkeep on her minuscule Arizona teacher's salary. That house could be her ideal retirement home, far exceeding any affordable options in Phoenix. She owned it outright. Her only financial obligations would be taxes and a trust paid to the Mexican government, along with utilities. Mexico, with its serene beaches and tranquil sunsets, offered a beautiful haven in which to spend her golden years. And so, amidst the chaos of her present, Veronica found hope, painted in the warm colors of sandy browns, ocean greens, and sky blues, guiding her toward a peaceful future. But Mom, are you sure you can manage life alone in Mexico? Is it going to be safe down there? Her eldest son, Joseph, asked. There's only one way to find out, Veronica replied. Within a week, she had turned over her Phoenix house to the bank due to mounting debts. Unable to afford the $3,000 for a moving truck, her sons took on the task of packing her belongings, filled their cars to the brim, and formed a caravan to transport her to her Mexican home. Unable to afford the $3,000 for a moving truck, her sons took on the task of packing her belongings. They filled their cars to the brim and formed a caravan to transport her to her Mexican home. They brought her paintings, clothes, jewelry, and an extensive collection of books, though no furniture, as the house was already furnished. Now, you boys know that I don't drink much and I don't use drugs, Veronica reassured them. I've been a teacher all my life, so it's unlikely I'll get into trouble. I don't do wild late-night drunken parties, and I have my dogs to alert me if someone comes around. There's no need to worry about me. I also have the rental management company that makes my bill payments. They'll help me if I need anything. Her sons unloaded their cars, filled with their mother's cherished items, carefully unpacking a 12-place setting of Port Marion Botanic Garden china, a Spode Christmas china set, special gemstone pieces from the Tucson Gem and Mineral Show, her mother's own paintings, 4 Van Gogh reproductions, an assortment of collectibles, clothing for every season, and most significantly, her favorite novels and poetry books amassed over years as an English teacher. With everything in place, her new residence abroad truly became her own, a distinct space reflecting her life and passions. When her son's cars were empty, they returned to the United States, leaving Veronica in her new home. She felt a twinge of apprehension about her solitude in a foreign land, even though she had the means to stay connected with family and friends by phone. Yet this was her home, a space uniquely her own. Chapter 2. Having risen from humble beginnings, only to find herself back at square one, Veronica felt oddly at home. Despite attending private schools and living with the rich, she had never fully shed her sense of being an imposter. While she had developed a taste for finer things, she was far from a spoiled, little rich girl. Her father's frugality had remained with her, influencing her to seek out bargains. Although she and her children dressed impressively, thanks to carefully curated Goodwill finds, her inability to budget properly had led her through multiple bankruptcies and divorces. Yet, she had emerged unscathed, driven by an indomitable spirit, aided by her medication for depression, and not without hope for a better tomorrow. At this time in her life, following her second divorce, and with her children finally moving out, Veronica found herself alone. Well, not entirely. She still had Rudy and Riley, her loyal dogs, who she knew would protect her. Well, they were corgis, not Rottweilers, so they would not win in a WWE cage match, but they'd put up a good fight. She frequently pondered the sequence of choices that had brought her to this point. Alone in a foreign country, accompanied only by her dogs, she had never envisioned this in her later years. Both her marriages had drained her finances, leaving her only with the Mexican beach house her parents had bequeathed to her, a beautiful property a block from the ocean, to which her sons had recently moved her. Veronica, nearing 60, had always danced a precarious tango with finances and romantic liaisons. 2 bankruptcies and the looming threat of a third had plagued her. Now the time for her to carve her oath gleamed brightly before her. Deception of age ran through her veins. Her other had been a master of it, effortlessly maintaining a facade of eternal youth. Having blurred the year on her driver's license with a strategically spilled drop of nail polish and securing sworn oaths of age secrecy from her children, Veronica's preoccupation with maintaining her youthful image had never bothered her family. In fact, they embraced having an engaged, community-minded mother who encouraged participation in a plethora of activities, particularly those having to do with animals. A soft spot for creatures had always nestled in Veronica's heart, granting her a voice that roared and barked with compassion for all beings great and small. From childhood, her parents had recognized her extraordinary connection with animals. Horses grew serene under her guidance, and chickens miraculously laid more eggs in her soothing presence. The twinkle in her eye upon meeting a new creature sparked such joy that her parents implored her to consider veterinary school. But Veronica, moved by her passion for literature, a gift from her father, and inevitably, by the whims of her heart, where poetry and writing were concerned, chose English and teaching instead. Her father, on the other hand, was an intellectual at heart. He had emphasized the importance of higher education and world exploration, cultivating their house to be a home filled with books that ranged from law cases and classic literature to cookbooks. This collection also included what he playfully termed his wife's trashy novels, which were in fact popular bestsellers. A true Renaissance man, he had imparted the joy of lifelong learning to his children, filling their basement with bookshelves that were as diverse in genre as they were abundant in number. The decision to write, then, felt like destiny to Veronica. She had pursued a career in teaching English and held a lifelong love for books. Visiting libraries and bookstores felt like coming home. Now, as a new resident in a foreign land, she decided to channel her love of the written word differently by starting a community newsletter. Understanding the importance of fitting in, especially in a foreign country, she set out to connect with her new community. Her dogs could offer love, but not real protection, so community ties were essential for her peace of mind. Taking the initiative, Veronica went door to door in her American-dominated neighborhood, soliciting articles, announcements, and affordable advertising for her bi-weekly newsletter. Thus, the Las Olas Times was born. Initially sparse, the paper eventually grew to feature a variety of content, including local business news, personal interviews, art and writing contests, local recipes, tidal weather reports, and life events ranging from births to deaths. Over time, it swelled to 10, 20 pages of community-contributed material, becoming an indispensable resource and a symbol of the interconnected lives of those who read it. Starting her day with a cup of coffee, flavored with calorie-free creamer to mimic the luxury of a high-end coffee shop treat, Veronica settled in front of her computer to work on the next edition of her community newsletter. Once a victim of financial ruin, she had learned the value of frugality. The absence of her former husband, Joe, left her alone, but also allowed her the freedom to take up a new endeavor. Although the newsletter began as a way to fill her time, it also satisfied her unspoken, nosy curiosity about the lives of her neighbors. This endeavor gave her an excuse to interact with the community. Veronica learned about local happenings, whether it was the struggling business placing a going out of business ad or the heartbroken individual sharing a melancholy poem about a recent breakup. She even discovered where to find the best tamales during the holiday season. Funding the project out of her pocket, Veronica never expected any pushback until she ran afoul of the Homeowners Association for using the community name Las Olas in her newsletter's title. To defuse the situation, she renamed it Rudy and Riley's Gazette after her faithful dogs. Wheeling a small wagon loaded with freshly printed newsletters, with Rudy and Riley trotting ahead, was the highlight of her delivery days. As she made her rounds, neighbors welcomed her into their homes, offering beverages and snacks, along with additional stories for future newsletter editions. Her visits were generally pleasant, except for the inevitable HOA violation notice from Harry Hillsdale, the cantankerous president of the Homeowners Association. Though he had initially objected to the newsletter, claiming it violated some unspecified board policy, he eventually relented. All he required was a disclaimer on the front page stating that the publication was not endorsed by the Las Olas Community Property HOA. Of course, there were a few homes that Veronica chose to avoid. She would get a sudden migraine every time she and the dogs even tried to walk one step up their driveway. The old man with the ferocious pit bulls was not very pleasant, and she felt what her son, Harry, called her spidey senses, get very up in arms every time she went near his house. He didn't want her there, and she didn't want to be there. It was a mutual agreement. The experience was a subtle reminder that even well-intentioned community projects could ruffle feathers, but for Veronica, it was all worth it. Every edition of Rudy and Riley's Gazette not only deepened her connection with her neighbors, but also strengthened the community's bonds with each other. Just down the street, Veronica met an intriguing couple, Dave and Irene Verducci. Dave had recently purchased their house for the surprising sum of $100,000 after the original owner had passed away. Not interested in living in Mexico, the owner's sister had decided to sell. Dave, hearing about the deal from the longtime caretaker of the property, an old construction buddy, consulted his wife. Irene took one look at the property and instructed him to write a check immediately. The couple had been married for 40 years. Dave was a contractor and Irene a secretary. Dave's philosophy for maintaining a happy marriage was to buy his wife a condo in another country. They had been visiting Mexico for years, and Dave credited the trips with strengthening their marital bond. Soon, Irene and Veronica started spending time together, often visiting the Malecón for drinks and conversation. Veronica would bring her dog, Riley, for protection and companionship. "Your dog seems incredibly in tune with you," Irene observed. "She stops when you stop and sits when you sit. What else can she do?" "Believe it or not, Riley is something of a detective. She's helped me solve a few cases." "It may sound crazy, but we have a unique understanding of each other," Veronica confided. Irene chuckled. "Well, that does sound a bit far-fetched, no pun intended. But I know dogs have heightened senses and perceptions that we don't fully understand. Perhaps you have a deeper connection with Riley than most people have with their pets. Let's leave it at that." "Thanks for not thinking I'm crazy," said Veronica, relieved. "I didn't say that," Irene replied. And they both broke into laughter, pouring just a little more cement into their already building friendship. Along with creating a social life, every day Veronica worked diligently to transform her father's aging property into a welcoming home. The cracked white stucco that adorned the exterior was a major concern. Not only did the cracks need filling and the walls painted, but the backyard wall also required an extension to give the dogs a secure area for doing their business. She sought local expertise to tackle the problem. Despite her limited Spanish, she relied on Google Translate for assistance. One contractor, Roberto Cameron, arrived in a flashy Cadillac and quoted her 45,000 pesos, an exorbitant amount that felt like buying a new car. Then came Ernesto Moriega in his battered red pickup truck, who offered to do the job for just 30,000 pesos. Veronica hired him on the spot. Her father had always taught her to never trust the worker who came in his new car because that was what you would end up paying for. It also showed that he was used to getting his hands dirty and working hard. "That's the kind of person you want working for you," her father would say. Water supply was another pressing issue. To ensure a more consistent flow, Veronica invested in a 1000-gallon tank. However, due to periodic water shortages in her part of town, she remained at the mercy of the city's supply. She discovered she could pay for additional water, at $100 per week to fill her tank, if she ever ran out. It was a costly backup plan, but one that provided peace of mind. These were the realities of life in Puerto Bella. Chapter 3. Though the prospect of a beautiful future now awaited her, Veronica couldn't shake off the nagging feeling of betrayal. She felt cheated by her sister Karina, suspecting that she could have had more than just this house if Karina hadn't sold their family home. Veronica knew she needed to let go and move on, but her current home had only narrowly escaped her sister's grasp. For now, she harbored no warm feelings toward Karina. "I'll only agree to turn the house over to you if you reimburse me $3,000 for this year's fees that I already paid," Karina said. "Fine, I'll send the money via Zelle," Veronica replied. "I could make you pay for all the renovations I did," Karina added, "but I guess that would be unsisterly of me, wouldn't it?" "You have stayed there many times over these 16 years, didn't you? So haven't those renovations benefited you as well? Besides, I have had to redo all the shoddy workmanship of the plumbing system, update the water system, replace all the faucets, and start having monthly pest control to make sure that we aren't infested with bugs," Veronica countered. Karina said nothing, accepted the $3,000, and coldly walked away. She knew Veronica was right, and she didn't care about the property anymore, only what she could make from it. Veronica had inherited her father's do-it-yourself work ethic. "No sense in paying someone else what you can fix yourself," he would often say. When she lived in the house on Helen Street, after her first divorce, she was reminded of this saying every time the closet light automatically turned on when its door swung open. Years later, even in her home in Mexico, traces of her father's peculiar taste could be seen everywhere. Non-matching light switch plates, some adorned with Mexican pottery designs, and others featuring jumbled patterns, like moose and bears, decorated the walls. The wrought iron screen doors at the entrances also embodied his eclectic style. One was a fitting copper color with a sunray design, while the other two, green with a palm tree and turtle, and blue with a bubble pattern, seemed out of place. "Dad never settled for the ordinary," she mused to herself. Thankfully, the house had since been updated with modern conveniences like air conditioning, cable, and Wi-Fi, dragging it into the 20th century. However, part of the allure of vacationing in Mexico had always been the opportunity to disconnect and unwind. In days past, the round table had been the gathering point for late-night games of Trivial Pursuit, a place where everyone focused on each other rather than their electronic devices. Nowadays, with smartphones and television providing constant distractions, even she found herself giving in to the magnetic pull of a good movie, though not before she had counted the stars in the crisp, clear night sky. One night, Veronica found herself in her usual spot, this time with her chair facing the dunes rather than the ocean. She gazed upwards at the cosmic display, jokingly crediting it to "Yours truly, God," while her dogs listened attentively. As she moved, she realized she had left the balcony lights on. Pausing by the first lantern, she admired the intricate De Grazia-style painting of a small child on its porcelain surface. She wondered if her mother, who had taken up painting in her later years, had crafted it. Inspired, Veronica decided to conduct a museum tour of the outside lanterns. She examined each one in turn, speculating about the history behind them. With four lanterns to inspect, the activity consumed some time. However, as she reached the spot where the last lantern should have been, she found herself engulfed in darkness. Despite the heavenly light shown above, this corner of the house remained hauntingly dark, a space where a lantern would have been more than welcome as midnight approached. Somewhat shaken, Veronica hurried back inside to grab her brightest flashlight. Anticipating a burnt-out bulb, she also took a fresh one and a small step ladder. When she shone the flashlight on the unlit lantern, she found it didn't match the other.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.